Hello and welcome to What's In It for Africa, the Inside the Issue show with me, Uzomadu, where we unravel the EU-Africa current affairs landscape. This is a special edition of the Inside the Issue show called Ambassadors Talk, where we speak to a selection of African ambassadors about the EU-Africa relationship, concentrating on their national relationship with the European Union. This time around, Ethiopian Ambassador Teshome Toga speaks to What's In It for Africa about the African economy, EU-Africa relations, trade, migration, and of course, Brexit. In terms of the economy, moving away from dependency on primary commodities has really been the issue in terms of turning African potential into a reality. This is because it can guard against vulnerabilities or external economic shocks, such as low oil prices or the economic slowdown that we've seen in China. And so it's very interesting that Ethiopia is only one of two African countries that have had successive economic growth over a decade, which has not been linked to a natural resource boom. And so they haven't been dependent on primary commodities. So we spoke to the Ethiopian ambassador to see if the Ethiopian economic growth model is a blueprint for Africa. So what are the Ethiopian lessons learned for other African countries wanting to diversify, especially those heavily dependent on mineral or oil wealth, such as Mozambique, Nigeria, or the DRC?
We knew that we don't have much oil resource. We do not have surplus capital. What we had actually as a country and what we have right now is first and foremost our population, second our land resource, water resource, and the level of our own people with limited capital. So if you start economic development and growth, definitely that clearly indicates where you should start from and where your basis of your policy should be. So Ethiopia first defined what it has and what it has not. And that's, I think, the first step we have taken. Secondly, given the resources we have at our own disposal, then we decided to put agricultural-led industrialization as our major economic strategy. So naturally, you should start with agriculture because we have enough land resources, we have water resources, and then, of course, most importantly, we have the labor of our farmers. So the combination of these resources would definitely be a starting point for Ethiopia's economic growth. And we have been doing this in the last 10, 11, 12 years. And of course, those resources alone are not enough. You have to mobilize the farmers, you have to train them, and you have also give them modern agricultural extension services. Combination of all this surely assured us double-digit growth in the last 11, 12 years. We knew that we cannot continue depending on agriculture because it has its own limits. Of course, agriculture still plays a very significant and dominant role in the economy in terms of export, in terms of labor, in terms of GDP. At a certain point, of course, in time, and as our strategy clearly indicates that we would start with agriculture but will end up in industrialization. So in the last 5 years, we started to bring about is structural change in the economy, and in order to do that, we came up with a growth and transformation plan. The transformation plan involves basically moving from agricultural, totally agricultural-led economy to manufacturing and industrialization gradually. So that is in the process, but in that process again, agriculture continues to play a very important role. What are the lessons? I think the lessons for us is the role of government, and then of course, coming up with appropriate policy and strategy, and then of course, mobilization of all the necessary inputs. For us, again, creating the necessary environment, including peace and stability, also was very, very crucial.
And then EU-Ethiopia and EU-Africa relations became the focus of the discussion. And actually, the ambassador is well placed to talk on this issue. Not only is he the representative of his country to the European Union, but Ethiopia is home to the headquarters of the African Union.
How would you describe EU-Africa relations and EU-Ethiopia relations specifically? Do you think it's gone beyond the donor aid relationship?
Well, the current narrative is partnership, and the indications are that on both sides that we should definitely move from the donor-recipient context to a new partnership. The donor-recipient concept has totally been removed. I'm not yet sure, but as I've said, there is a very strong will on both sides that we should really move to strategic engagement, to strategic partnership. And I think that is what is happening in the case of Ethiopia. Now, EU-Africa relationship, historically, Africa has a very strong, long-standing relationship with EU. Of course, the context is totally different, but now EU remains a very important partner for Africa. At the same time, I would urge to add that Africa is also a very important partner for EU. I think we should not miss that critical element. The view has been for long that it is only EU which is important because it donates money for our development. That's true. But I think Africa is changing. Africa has changed for the better. And there is a new narrative, I think, and the reality in Africa that Africa is growing, Africa is developing, Africa is democratizing. I think Africa is also moving in terms of peace and stability, and then is becoming a very important player in global issues. We are mindful of our limitations, our difficulties, our challenges in Africa. And of course, the generalization I make about Africa does not represent, I think, each and individual country. There are countries who have done really extremely well when it comes to democracy, good governance, economic development, including my own country. Those changes, I think, are critical so that EU looks at Africa not as a recipient country, but I think as a continent that can be really a very important global player. And I think that is in the making. It is in the process. What will matter for me, as far as I am concerned, is I think what we do in Africa. I think if we put our house in order, if we really take good care of our own economy, if we really do democratize our country for our own sake, then we will not have EU, only EU as a partner, but we will have other major players who are wishing and who are willing to work with Africa. And EU remains Ethiopia's major trading bloc. As a bloc, maybe in a peak season of our export, 40% of our trade ends up in EU countries. That makes EU critical for Ethiopia. We have about 400 EU member countries, companies, private companies investing in Ethiopia. It could be bigger, but I think it is also a very important indication. We work very closely with EU in making our region peaceful and stable. We work very closely in addressing the problem of Somalia, the crisis in South Sudan, and then, of course, the issue of migration, fighting terrorism, of course, addressing the issue of climate change and the sustainable development goals. In all this, EU and EU is important. But at the same time, Ethiopia is also important for EU because we are hosting about over 800,000 refugees that might have, if not all, maybe half or more might have crossed to Europe, and we are hosting them in Ethiopia.
And moving on from EU-Africa relations, since the EU is not the only player on the continent, we decided to move on to speaking about Africa's other international partners. First up, China.
To hone in on other partners other than the EU, do you see that the increasing influence of, you know, places like China, India, Japan that you've referred to before, might be in competition somehow with the EU and their influence in Africa and Ethiopia? Or do you think, you know, there is a good working relationship? How do you see that competition?
I think if we are sincere enough, I think I wouldn't put it, I think, as a competition. I would even call it as complementary. I believe that China is focusing on a certain area of issues. EU, of course, has its own vital interest, and we also trade with EU, we also trade with China, but the nature of the relationship with EU is in a certain element, is a certain way, is different than our engagement with China. Of course, we always hear this criticism that China is exploiting Africa. China is really doing business with Africa where they don't really put much care about human rights issue. And then, of course, there are these attitudes. But frankly speaking, who does, you know, more investment? Who does more trade with China? Is it Africa or EU? It is EU and China that actually move half a trillion investment and half a trillion trade and then significant investment in China. It is West companies of the West. So we have our own interests with China. We have our own interests in interests with EU. The same thing with others, actually. Africa should not really choose one particular partner. Africa should work with any partner that is willing to work with Africa. Now, there is a very important element there, I think. First and foremost, of course, Africa should define its interest. Then any partner that wishes to work with Africa on the basis of the policies and the strategies and the interests that Africa has defined for itself, everybody is welcome. And we have, I believe, we have enough space. We have enough space. We have, I think, enough resources to really work together. I believe Africa is now maturing and mature enough to define its own interest. We are not, I think, in a position where we can allow a given country come and then exploit our resources. I think that should be a little bit exaggeration. I'm not saying that there is no problem of management of resources. I'm not saying that there is no element of corruption. I'm not trying to defend that Africa is just a perfect continent. No, we are not. Like any other continent, we have our own problems, our own limitations and weaknesses. But I think the most important thing is not that you have a weakness, but if you identify your weakness and then address and then improve, that's how life goes on, actually. So that's the view I would like to look at our relationship with EU and then, of course, with other partners.
Then the interview turned to Africa-Israel relations, because the recent visit of Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu to Rwanda, Uganda, Kenya and Ethiopia made him the first Israeli Prime Minister to visit the continent for over 30 years. Now, as a result of the visit, Kenya and Ethiopia supported Israel's observer bid to the African Union. Also, there were discussions on further business and investment deals. So we spoke to the Ethiopian ambassador to find out more.
What was the motivation for supporting Israel's bid for African Union observer status? And also, I'd like to understand, is this the beginning of, you know, improving ties between Israel and Ethiopia and Israel and Africa, especially if we look at the Ethiopian context with Ethiopian Jews in Israel and some of the difficulties that have been there?
Now, the relationship between Israel and Africa has been, as you know, a bit complicated because of the question of Palestine. Africa has been supporting as a continent, as a union, the cause of Palestine. And of course, we have been also doing that, but that never affected our other aspect of our relationship. Now, the Prime Minister clearly declared that he Israel would like to come back to Africa in a very big way, and he wants Africa also to be involved in Israel or to come to Israel in a very big way. So that's a new declaration, a very important declaration in my view. Now, for us, the motivation is we would like to really make use of Israeli technology. We would like to make use of Israeli's private sector to invest in Ethiopia. Quite a number of them are already doing. We would like to use really the Ethiopian Jews, now Israelis, to come back to their country of origin and then be a bridge in technology transfer, knowledge transfer, and be a bond of link, a natural bond of link between our two countries. That is our focus, actually. The Prime Minister also, the Israeli Prime Minister also called Ethiopians to invest in Israel. And that's, I think, a sure way of last longing relationship. So we are working on people-to-people relationship. Government-to-government relationship is very important because that relationship should be guided by government policies and strategy. Israel used to have an observer status in the African Union, and in the best interest of seeking solution to the Middle East crisis between, the Israelis and Palestinians, I think giving fair hearing to both sides will be beneficiary. Taking side will not solve the problem. That's why Ethiopia's policy when it comes to Israeli and Palestinian problem has always been a neutral one. We have been encouraging both sides to really engage with each other and then, of course, address the problem in a very peaceful way and then come up with a solution that is mutually acceptable. I think the people of Israel and the Palestinian people should live side by side in peace, in harmony, and that is our will. And we would always encourage for a peaceful settlement of the problem. It is in that spirit, if we are to really support Israelis coming back to Africa, that is it.
And an interview on EU-Africa current affairs would not be complete without discussing two burning issues set to change EU-Africa relations indefinitely. First of all, the Economic Partnership Agreement, and in this case, the one between the Eastern and Southern African region and the European Union, which is a trade and development agreement. Also, the burning issue on everybody's lips, Brexit.
As a member of the Eastern and Southern African regional bloc, what is your view on some of the possible challenges but also opportunities of an economic partnership agreement with the European Union?
The economic partnership agreement, as you know, has been on the table under negotiation for now 16 years. It started with the Cotonou partnership agreement. Then we have a different configuration for negotiation, as you know, and Ethiopia belongs to the Eastern and Southern Africa configuration. We have been negotiating over the years. It has been a very difficult one, actually. Our purpose of partnership is to really change the concept of aid into trade and then trade for development. And in order to do that, we want a fair deal for all of us. We also would like to have all ESA countries to really conclude the deal together. But apparently, we have four countries already signing the interim agreement in 2019, but not yet implemented. And they would like to move forward. And then there are experiences that are actually coming up. The first group that signed EPA and were entered into full implementation in the CARICOM on the Caribbean. And after 6 years of full implementation, the Caribbean are now complaining whether EPA has brought them the full benefits that they all expect to get from EPA. So that's a food for thought, and I think there are lessons for all of us from there. Secondly, other configuration, for instance, the ECOWAS in West Africa. There are three, four countries now, including Nigeria, who wish that EPA should be renegotiated. So you can see that the negotiation is very challenging, but EU, of course, is also putting pressure on the ACP countries, including Ethiopia. So the final line of argument is that, sure, we will negotiate. We have no urgent right because, as I said, EU is a very important trading partner as a bloc for Ethiopia. But we are also doing a negotiation with WTO, so we'll certainly we will certainly make sure that we conclude an agreement that is important for Ethiopia, but also important for our partners. There should be, I think, an understanding between the two sides. But the challenge is enormous in terms of even negotiating capacities. Yeah. So those are some of the challenges we are facing.
I'm sure that you've heard that actually the Eastern African Community Economic Partnership Agreement is now in jeopardy following the Brexit vote. And so I'd like to know from you, what do you see being some of the results for Africa and Ethiopia as a result of Brexit? Is it good news? Is it bad news?
Well, at this stage, I will give you only my personal opinion. My personal opinion, it's not a good news. It's not a good news for Britain, UK. It's not a good news for European Union. And it's not good, I think, news for us who are partners of UK through European Union. Now, what is the implication for Ethiopia? What is the implication for ACP? What is the implication for UK? What is the implication for European Union? I think this is something that everybody is now analyzing in the study. We are also really trying to look at its implication vis-a-vis our relationship with UK. And then, of course, our relationship through ACP to EU. Now, regarding UK-Ethiopia relationship, the exit, in my view, would not have a major or significant impact or negative impact, I believe, because our bilateral relationship is very strong. We work very closely with the current government. Since the party, the ruling party and the government has a very strong and positive policy towards Ethiopia, we believe that even if there is going to be a change of guard, there will not be a very negative impact in our relationship bilaterally. With Africa, of course, we have been dealing within the framework of EU-Africa strategy. We have been dealing with UK within the framework of ACP-EU partnership agreement. Now, the fact that UK has exited, then definitely there are certain adjustments that need to be done. First and foremost, I think, for me, is that the European Development Fund, to which UK contributes significantly. So there will be a reduction, in my view, unless the remaining 27 countries would like to compensate for it, there will be a reduction in EDF. And we have already made allocations and then budgeting and so on and so forth. So the fact that the contribution coming from UK will not be there will have, I think, some impact on our development finance that we normally get from Europe. We'll see how it works out. I believe our relationship with EU, unless it is for resources, should not have a very negative impact.
And last but not least, migration. Since Ethiopia hosts around 800,000 refugees from South Sudan, Somalia and Eritrea, which do contribute to the migratory flows to Europe, we decided to speak about the European Commission's proposal aimed at several African countries to address migratory flows to Europe. What is your opinion on possible new proposals coming from the European Commission, which essentially look at funding African countries, for example, Ethiopia, in return for promises to kind of stem the flow of migrants coming to Europe? And I really ask you this in the context of how many, you know, refugees and migrants you also host in your own country.
What we are trying to do is to really work a project so that, you know, young people could get a job and they settle in their country instead of leaving their country, that they stay in their country and depending again on the country, depending on the country, then you come up with several projects. In our case, we are focusing on small and micro enterprises, which can really create jobs for our young people. That's the main thing. Then there are people who would like to come to Europe for other reasons, and then those I think should be given opportunity to come to Europe, I think, in a legal manner. The other thing is, of course, we need to manage our borders. We also need to tackle the issue of smugglers and smugglers and traffickers. This is a very serious issue, actually. By the way, Ethiopia has done a very important work when it comes to traffickers and smugglers. We worked with our neighbors and we worked with Interpol, and we have brought about 300 smugglers into the court of justice. If people take action, I think if countries take similar actions, we believe that I think even if we cannot stop it, then we can bring this evil act of trafficking and smuggling to a certain limit. And so there are several projects. So it is actually a resource for implementation of the several growth, use opportunity, creating training and so on and so forth. So it's not money that simply handed to an African country. Now, EU is trying to respond to the public opinion, and that's quite natural, I think, in my view. And it has become a political issue because the far-right parties are gaining, I think, support nationally and, of course, in the context of European Union. So the mainstream parties are under pressure, and so they are trying to respond to that. Now, what we have done over the last year is that there has been a summit exclusively, actually, devoted to migration in Valletta, Malta. We have come up with a conclusion. I would say a compromise conclusion and then decisions. One of the decisions was, of course, to create what we call an emergency trust fund to regulate and manage migration. The resource, I believe, and of course, the African colleagues believe that it's not big enough. It's 1.8 billion, and it basically comes from the already committed European Development Fund. So we have about 1 billion from our reserve and then 800 million from regional indicative programs. And so essentially it's not a new envelope, it's not a new money, but be it so, we have to present projects and then of course get the resources released. Our assessment of the situation is that the release of the resource is very slow. We would have expected much more faster and then, of course, easier to access to the resources. I think that's one thing. On the other hand, of course, there are other elements, the legal issue, the legality issue, you know, allowing, encouraging legal migration to Europe, I think is very important. And we still see that that is also becoming a problem. It has, I think, there are issues that we need really to look into, the legal aspect of the migration. Then, of course, fighting traffickers and the smugglers is an issue. Border management is an issue. The issue of remittance is also very critical. Then, of course, for EU, one critical issue is returning illegal migrants, those who do not qualify for asylum. And that is a bit sensitive for many of our African colleagues, including my own country, because sometimes it is being politicized. So these are a very complex issue that we are trying to do, because you know the decision is made at individual level to migrate. It's not really a decision that a government takes.
And with that, I'd like to say thank you for Ethiopian Ambassador Teshome Toga for taking the time to speak with us. And thank you for watching and listening. And until next time, which is in September after the summer period, keep subscribing, liking, following and signing up to our monthly mailing list, which will still be sent out over the summer period. And remember to catch us at our second homes, Afroland TV and Quick TV Africa. Again, thanks for watching. My name is Izo Madu for What's In It For Africa.